All right. Well, we'll just give it a little more. Well, even if it's not your first time, if you want to just introduce yourself to new friends. Kara, after you, please.
Sorry, this is my first call as well. I'm actually a remote volunteer for a cat shelter in Western Pennsylvania, and I live in New Hampshire, so I'm not too far from Maine. I just was going through all the emails and I guess websites that I have and found this, so figured I'd join and get some more info because we're a very small shelter, all volunteers, about 15 of us, and we have about 150 to 200 cats.
Amazing. I'm going to echo what Mary Smith said. We love remote volunteers. How did you find out about that opportunity for your organization, and what do you do remotely for them?
Okay, well, I actually lived in Western Pennsylvania and went and adopted a cat and then another one and then another one. So I started volunteering there. And then my husband and I moved back to New Hampshire. So I just keep volunteering. And what I do for them is I do all the website. I design the website. I keep up with that. I keep up with the pet finder information. I do as much with grants as I can find for them. And I go back twice a year for a week to 2 weeks to help out.
Amazing. Well, all right, folks, looks like it's the top of the hour. Good morning. It is 8 a.m. Pacific Standard Time where I am located. My name is Bobby Mann. I'm the Maddie Human Animal Support Services Pilot Director. So honored to be hanging out with all of you. I have a very, very special guest along with Mary Smith, which is our other co-host for the day, Claire Callison. So Claire, welcome. Love for you to unmute, introduce yourself, and tell folks what you do.
Thanks, Bobby. Great to see everyone in our first call of the new year. I'm Claire Callison, and I work with Bobby here at in Austin, Texas, in American Pets Alive. And I focus on our supply and demand, pet supply and demand issues. So everything from transport programs to adoption policies and removing adoption barriers. So great to see all of you. Good morning.
And Claire, you want to give folks just a quick sneak peek into what the second half of this call is going to be all about?
Absolutely. Yes, we have the second half, we are going to focus on transport programs. And so we have four individuals from across the country. They are truly inspirations of mine. They're amazing. We're going to have a very genuine, open conversation about transport. We saw the data from Pet Health before the beginning of this year, and transports are down. We know that during 2021. So we want to just dive into it. We welcome all the questions, and we know you all are working in that space. So excited to hear from the people that are doing the work.
Amazing. Yes. And just a quick highlight for the rest of the call. We're going to be hearing from the amazing Erin Greenwood, who I see on this call, really about storytelling and pushing that narrative forward. And we're also going to be hearing from Jerrica Owen from the National Animal Control and Care Association about their new statement regarding appointment-based services. We know as we're moving into a more community-centric model, we want to be very, very intentional about the pathways that we plan for our pets. And so appointment-based systems are absolutely critical for that. So before that gets going, though, I have been waiting since 2021 to reintroduce my dear friend, Mary Smith, to kick us off with some Monday motivation. Over to you, Mary.
Thanks, Bobby. Hi, everybody. Claire, welcome. This is so great to see you all. So I guess I should take care of the most fun thing first, which is we're doing Maddie's Fund is giving away money. And we're giving away money for everybody who attends these calls live in person, as well as on demand. So you just need to register. You can register as many times as you want. And at the end of the month, there'll be a random drawing, and we'll be giving away $5,000 a month for the Monday call and $5,000 a month for the Friday call. Now, it might be one $5,000 grant. It might be four $1,000 grants. It might be two $2,500 grants. We don't know. Everything is going to be randomized. It's sort of a throwback to the days when we used to have real in-person conferences. You guys remember those days, right? And we used to do slot machines and games and all sorts of things at our booth to give away money. It was our attempt to just demystify the whole notion of grant giving and to try to make it fun. Because after all, Maddie's Fun is fun. At least we try to be. So I hope you guys will sign up for it. Allison put a link in the chat file. We'll probably do it again halfway through the meeting and maybe at the end as well, just so that you all have a chance to sign up for it. And we're excited to be able to do this. And I'm really excited to be able to share with you that this was the brainchild of Dr. Lori Peek, who is part of the executive leadership team at Maddie's Fund. She thought it would be a great way to just keep people engaged, invite new people to come on board, and also to be able to share some of our resources with all of you. So I'm so excited to be here, you guys. I was really trying to think of something profound, like what did I learn from 2021? And I have to be honest with you, I don't think I learned a fucking thing last year. I mean, I was trying to think, was it this, was it that? Nothing. Nothing is like bubbling to the surface. So I would invite you all, if there is something that you have learned about 2021, please go to the forum and I will meet you there, and we can perhaps some of your lessons learned will spark some of those things for me as well. I'm trying to be more present these days and not kind of future trip on what the world might look like 30, 60, 90 days from now. So it's really hard for me to look back and think, was there anything that I learned? But there is something that I heard on Sunday that I thought was kind of cool. And I heard this woman speak, and she was talking about one of her intentions for 2022 is to be smaller. I'm not talking about weight loss. I'm talking about our egos and how oftentimes in the work that we do, it's easy for us to be in a situation where we have to make certain judgments about people, places, and things, about the animals in our care, about the people that walk through our door, or send us an email or call us on the phone. And if we can be smaller, we might have a better opportunity, a better chance to really be of service to all of those people. And that's actually why we do what we do, to be of service to the people and pets in our community. I know we talked a lot since COVID has hit about both ends of the leash, but I think I've come around to the fact that we all remember what two ends of the leash look like. We just need to be much more vigilant in making sure that we honor both ends of the leash the way we want to be honored. And so with that, I'm going to just say thank you all for being here. I so love seeing you all. And I'm excited about the way you continue to inspire me. So Bobby, with that, I'm out. Claire, I'm glad you're here.
Man, putting the fun and the funds and blessing us with all of that knowledge. Mary Smith, it is so exciting. We are so grateful that y'all are making this investment into this call. Couldn't do it without you. It's been an amazing year last year. Looking forward to this year. Folks, $5,000 per call. I know Allison's going to drop a link into the chat where you're going to actually be able to register. They have this cool automated gizmo at the end of the month that starts blessing people. Mary, Shutterfly ain't got shit on us, right? People watch Ellen, right? Is that where those big ass checks are always from? It's from Shutterfly? Well, ours are from Maddie's Fund, and we absolutely love it. All right, we're going to get it kicked off into national updates, but before we open up the floor, we're going to head straight to Jerrica Owen for her update.
Good morning, all. Thank you, Mary. I love starting my week with that knowledge. Man, such a great way to start the week. So thank you for that, and thank you, Bobby. Just wanted to jump on here real quick and share that. Well, first of all, Happy New Year. If I haven't said that to you all yet, Happy New Year. So I'm with NACA, National Animal Care and Control Association, and in the last 2 weeks, NACA has released two different statements. So the first one is one that focuses on appointment-based pet intake into shelters. So it talks about the positives for implementing as well as some of the consequences. We know that how and when you take animals into your facility greatly impacts your capacity for care, staff morale, and the ability for your teams to really provide customer service for people and the animals. So by managing maybe the hours you take or the owner surrenders versus the strays, any of this type of stuff that you can do to implement at your shelter is really going to help. I think one of the most common misconceptions is we hear that people think managed means limited, and it doesn't refer to the actual number of animals. It refers to the process by which they come in. So we are going to we're going to come back to this call, I believe, in a couple of weeks. Bobby, correct me if I'm wrong, and dive a little bit more into it. But I did want to share that statement is available. We've received some fantastic feedback. Organizations are already taking it and using it to make some changes in their organizations. So NACA will be hosting a town hall on the 18th, so next Tuesday, to talk a little bit more about it. I will put the links in the chat for you to register for the town hall if you're interested. And then the second statement we released was a piece that was focused on the unprecedented time that we are experiencing right now, some of the ideas and suggestions that you and your organization can do to really help during these tough times. So I just wanted to quickly jump on, say all of that, and I look forward to seeing you all. And it's going to be a great 2022. Thank you, Bobby.
Jerrica, thank you so much. And so grateful to NACA and the amazing board there. I mean, starting off even just with a lot of the community cap conversations that were happening, now appointment-based sheltering models, you know, it really does take us moving that narrative forward together. Oftentimes, I think when people try to go through this change management in their communities, they feel very siloed. And, you know, a few people that are pushing their advocacy maybe make it difficult for people to really want to iterate and change. So as long as we keep doing it together and have places like NACA supporting us, I think we're all in good shape. So let's actually go to my sister, Sharon. Sharon from Maddie's Fund. I know you said there's some few new folks on this call, so let's call them out.
Happy New Year, everybody. I feel like I haven't been here in forever, and I was looking at all these names, and I'm like, there are a lot of new people. I'm curious to have you introduce yourself. I see Tammy Jennings. Tammy Wines Jennings, I've not met you before. It's nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. I am the assistant director for Washoe County Regional Animal Services in Reno, Nevada.
Fantastic. Congratulations on the Raiders, by the way. That was a close one. Kim Isel, you're next to her on my screen.
Hi, my name is Kim Isley. I'm president of the Animal League of Green Valley in Green Valley, Arizona.
Fantastic. Heather Hall, I've not seen you before.
Hi, yeah, I run a little rescue on the border of Texas in far west Texas called the Underground Dog. I think I'm gonna talk a little bit later.
Fantastic. Javier, I've met you on the call before?
I've been on the call throughout the year, but yeah, I'm Javier with LA County Animal Care Control, manager of the Downey Care Center.
Oh, terrific. Susan Kroon? You're on mute.
I'm not sure if you said Susan Shields or not, but I'm Susan Shields from Stray Cat Alliance here in Los Angeles, and I am the volunteer program manager. And I've been on these calls for about a year now, and I love these calls. I look forward to these calls on Monday morning, actually. So nice to see everybody, and Happy New Year.
Terrific. Susan Kroon. Yes, Susan, both Susans. Oh. Susan Kroon, I think you were on mute. Yeah, I think I saw you trying to speak and you were on mute.
Sorry, I was muted. My name is Susan Kroon. I'm president of the board of directors for Benches, which is Blue Earth Nicollet County Humane Society in Mankato, Minnesota, which is the southern section of Minnesota.
That's fantastic. Who else is new to the call today?
Mary? I am.
Oh, who's that?
Kelly. I'm Kelly Mitchell. I'm from Mountain Humane in Haley, Idaho.
Oh, wonderful. And Mary, was it Mary Flores that I saw?
Audra Murphy. Yes. From.
Yes. Hi, Mary.
Hi. I'm Mary Flores. I'm on the board of directors for Soul Dog Lodge and Training Center and Arizona Heartfelt Hounds in Tucson, Arizona.
Fantastic. I'm sorry, I spoke over someone just a moment ago.
Oh, that's okay, Sharon. I was just saying Audra from Field Haven Feline Center is new and on the call.
Hi, I'm Audra with Field Haven Feline Center. I am the operations coordinator, which is basically the equivalent of the junk drawer of titles. Whatever doesn't fit into another program kind of gets tossed at me. And one of my big programs is transfers. So I'm excited to be on this call and hear about that and meet all of you.
That's so wonderful. So nice
so
to meet
grateful.
You.
Thank you, Sharon, for helping us facilitate that. So many new folks. We hope to continue to see more of you. And remember, bring a friend. The goal is to build community, so the more people, the merrier. Let's keep it going for a couple more minutes with national updates. If there are any national organizations that would like to share something, now is the time.
Hey, Bobby, it's Courtney Cunningham here from Petco Love. I just wanted to send out that information again about our awesome vaccine campaign and our big push for our March initiative with getting 1 million owned pets vaccinated. I'll go ahead and drop some links and some more information in the chat for you guys.
Thanks, Courtney. And I owe you an email. I hope to have you on in 2 weeks. We do not have a meeting next week, but the following week to give a larger presentation on that.
Perfect. Thank you.
I'll jump in real quick. Claire Callison again, and I am so pleased to partner with Kelly Dewar of Maddie's Fund. This Thursday, we are launching our first webcast series. It's two-part series, and the theme is a transport program recharge. So we know a lot of you might be exhausted coming into this year, but we're hoping to share some new ideas, motivate your teams. And Kelly has some incredible tips on how to expand your foster program. And thanks, Allison, for putting the link to register in the chat. Thanks.
All right, all the great updates. Well, let's keep it rocking. I know a lot of what we talk about is that we're in the business of storytelling. In order for us to get better at the work that we do, we have to make sure that our communities are engaged and understand what our goals and visions are. So I'm going to go ahead and toss it right over to the amazing Erin Greenwood to talk to us all about storytelling.
Hi, I'm so excited to be here. Bobby and Kelly asked me to come on and just talk a little bit about narrative hooks in adoption bios and foster bios and animal welfare storytelling generally. So I put together just a little bare bones slideshow for this. My PowerPoint presentation skills are minimal, so please excuse this being a little bit amateur looking. I hope the information will be helpful. Here we go. Can you guys all see this?
Stop popping up for me yet, Erin.
No? Okay, let me see if I can figure this out. Share screen. Desktop, share. Oh, this is gonna take, sorry.
I think you need to be a co-host to share your screen if no one's made you a co-host yet.
Oh, Bobby, you wanna make me a co-host?
You actually should be good. This is, Maddie's make sure that these rooms are very inclusive so people can just pop it right on up. So give it another go, Erin, and let's see what happens.
Okay, it's asking me to, let's see. I'm sorry about this, guys.
No worries.
I do not know how to do this.
Do you wanna email it to us?
Yeah, why don't I do that?
Why don't you do that and I'll pull it up for you. While we're doing that, I know that we have a lot of new friends, but I see a lot of other old, amazing friends that have been coming to these calls that I think people should know who they are. So like Dr. Carly, I just saw you pop up. I'd love for you to introduce yourself and tell people who you are and what you do.
My voice is a little rusty this morning as I woke up with a cold, but I'm super excited about this call. I'm Dr. Carly. I'm an animal behaviorist and I've been working for Best Friends for the past 5 years in various roles. But now my focus is on applied animal behavior research and life-saving program research across the country at the high level. So I still work with animals, still work with dogs and cats and things like that. But that is what I do right now.
Well, we're so excited that you're here. Can everybody see my screen? Do y'all see this presentation?
Yes, I see it.
Okay. So Bobby, I'm just going to tell you when to switch to the next screen.
Perfect. I would love to be your assistant.
Switch to the next screen. So the sort of inspiration for this little talk was Kelly and Bobby were saying that they're often seeing foster pleas and adoption ads that start like this, just Fido is an 8-year-old neutered male, da da da. And that these are often coming along with a blurry intake photo. And that's how we're trying to kind of market our animals to the public. Next screen, please. So compare that to an ad like this. This one is from Kansas City Pet Project. This is for a cat named Rufus. Look at this little picture of him. What is it that jumps out at you about Rufus here? Anybody should just jump in. Or I'll say it. It's his little teethers. They're the teethers. Yeah, the teeth. I mean, you see this picture and you just love Rufus, don't you? And then you read this adoption ad and it calls him irresistible. It calls him beloved. It says he's a moon-faced dreamboat. I mean, you immediately feel like you have a connection with Rufus. All right, let's see the next screen. Bobby, you're a great assistant and I appreciate it. And this is Presley. Presley is a 10 to 12 year old dog who got pulled into Vintage Pet Rescue, this wonderful elderly pet sanctuary in Rhode Island. And this is what they had to say about him in the first line. They gave his age and then they said he's an absolute joy. They gave some descriptions of where he was found, why he's in rescue. And then they say he's extremely handsome. He's quiet, mellow, loves walks, and appears to be housebroken. He would love a home with a cozy bed. And you just feel this instant connection to Presley. Next screen, please. Here's Milk. Look at Milk. I mean, this is an elderly dog who has some eye problems. And yet you look at this photo and you look at this adoption ad and all you want is to give Milk a hug and then to bring him to your house or to share him on your Facebook page. Yeah, I want to boop Milk also. I mean, this is what this ad is designed to do, make you want to boop Milk right on the nose. All right, let's see the next one. And here's Fezziwig, who needed to go into rescue. Now, this was done almost like a concert poster. And it just says right at the top, she would love almost any foster family. I mean, you immediately start getting a sense of who this dog is. The graphic design of it just draws you right in. The description of Fezziwig and her hard luck story and why she needs help now. I mean, this makes you feel a connection to Fezziwig. And then we've got one more. Prancer, the traumatized Victorian child. It doesn't always have to be the good pets who are marketed well. Sometimes the really, really bad ones have the best adoption ads. So this is Prancer, the traumatized Victorian child, whose brutally honest adoption ad went wildly viral. And it was just one of the best adoption ads I've ever seen. Can we go to the next screen? So what does all this mean? So these adoption ads do more than just present straight facts. What they're doing is they're telling you a story about the pets. And what's the difference between facts and a story? Facts are just kind of, I mean, even just straight facts are a story, but facts are kind of presenting details in a removed, unemotional way as if kind of robots are about to be looking at them and they don't care about emotion and they don't care about feeling. They don't care about connection. They just want to know the exact sort of biographical details so that they can process some information. But that's not how humans operate. Can I get the next slide? Humans are storytelling animals. We understand and process the world through narrative. And that's why every single newspaper and magazine article you see starts with an anecdote. It's because even the ones that are telling you, this is a story about veterinary shortages after lots of people brought home pets during the pandemic. It doesn't start off giving you facts and figures. It starts off telling you a story about a veterinarian's office that's trying to accommodate all of the new pets that have come into the community. Can I have the next screen? So what does this actually mean for you? It means that every time you're communicating with the public, you have the opportunity to do more than just sort of present hard and cold facts. You have the opportunity to tell a story and to draw people in, the public, the media, everybody in, to feel engaged with your animals and to feel engaged with your organization. So some tips as far as that goes, don't be afraid to develop your own narrative voice. Your Facebook ads, your adoption ads, they don't have to sound like everybody else's. They should sound like you. I mean, it's sort of the best case scenario if every time somebody reads an adoption ad, they can say, oh yeah, I know that shelter. I love their adoption ads and I can always tell that it's one of theirs because they do such a great job with their storytelling for their animals. Now, stories are obviously, we usually think of stories as being made of words, but sometimes it's a picture that tells you a story or provides you a hook for a story. So make sure that your animal care staff and your fosters are always providing you a lot of pictures that you can choose from. Empower them to use their cell phones and take pictures all of the animals that they are caring for. They know these animals the best, and they will be the ones who know, you know, when Roxy settles in for a nap at 1:30 p.m., she makes the cutest little ear flap with her, you know, right ear. And I want to capture that picture because adopters are going to fall in love with that too. You know, videos are a great way to tell a story as well. You know, we all walk around with these sort of video making computers in our pockets all the time. Use that to your advantage. You can always tell a better story when you have the visuals to go along with it. These are just two pictures that, back of one again. These are two pictures that when I was still working as a journalist, before I even knew what the stories were with these pictures, I knew I wanted to write stories about them. So the one on the left, was up, this was years ago now, up on the Lifeline Animal Project Facebook page. And I saw the picture and I just said, I have to know what this is and I have to write about it. And it turned out it was this wonderful story of a dog who had come into the shelter who was just absolutely beloved by the shelter staff, and they were healing her through some very traumatic things. The picture on the right was a woman who had adopted this dog from one of the shelter in Philadelphia, I think. And this dog just fell in love with her and she fell in love with the dog, and somebody snapped this picture and put it up on Facebook. And this picture alone became the hook for just a lovely story about an adoption that had gone really well. And this story, I like to tell this because it makes me feel a little bit proud of my viral skills, but I ended up writing that one for the Today Show, the Today Show's website. And my editor said that it got more clicks than Beyonce's baby announcement. So that's just to tell you, like, this is how powerful stories about animals and human connection are. Okay, next slide. So what does this mean for you? What this means is every time you're thinking about a story that you want to tell, think about the details that really grab you, or the ones that you want to call and tell your parents about, the ones that you want to tell your best friends about. These are the stories that are going to grab the public too. These are the details that are going to grab the public too. And it's the same with pictures. If you take a picture of a pet who's in your care and you can't stop looking at this picture and you go show it to all of your coworkers, you text it to your best friend, that's the picture. There's no science to this. It's art, it's feeling, it's instinct. You know, you get a sense for which of these pictures just make your heart go pitter patter. And those are going to be the ones that make other people's hearts go pitter patter too. Those are the ones that you share, those details, those photos, those videos, because those are the ones that the public are really going to grab onto as well. And if you've got a haunted Victorian child on your hands, like Prancer, lean into it. You do not have to make every pet sound like they're the model citizen. You know, we're human, they're pets, you know, we all have our quirks. You lean into it and make sure that you've just described them. You know, you want to do it in a loving way. That's a very important part of this. You want to make sure that your affection for them comes through, because these types of adoption ads will not work if you don't love this pet, if you don't, you know, if you feel anger toward the pet or contempt toward the pet or anything like that, it's not going to work. If you love this pet, even with their flaws, these ads are going to work. So here's one that I really love. She's just a jerk. The brutal honesty makes sheltered cat internet sensation. This is Perdita, who like to stare into your soul until you feel as if you may never be cheerful again. I mean, we all know pets like this, and it's, you know, there may be a time that the internet gets sick of these sorts of ads, but it hasn't happened yet. So keep trying them. Next screen, please. So the other thing, I know it can sound very overwhelming. You want to tell stories about all these pets. You have to go find all these details. Don't get overwhelmed by it. I mean, this is an opportunity. It's not sort of a, now you need to be a Pulitzer Prize winning journalist. Just think about the adoption ads that we looked at. Most of them just added a couple of details here and there about a pet that made them go from sort of anonymous 8-year-old Fido to, you know, heartthrob 8-year-old Fido to the sweetest dog you've ever met. You know, it does not have to be a big deal what you're looking for. It just has to be. So like Presley, the dog who we saw, he's an absolute joy of a dog who's quiet, mellow, loves walks, and appears to be housebroken. And this got him adopted. He got adopted from this ad. Rufus the cat was a bit of a hot mess of medical concerns when he arrived at the shelter, but he was transformed from a not so ugly duckling into this beautiful swan This is the cat with the teethers. You know, you have pets like this who you can describe with that kind of love and attention and detail too. Next slide, please. And of course, Prancer. Prancer was the demonic Chihuahua, who's a haunted Victorian child in the body of a small dog that hates men and children. And this ad got him adopted. I mean, he went mega viral and he got adopted. And not only did the ad get him a lot of attention, but it helped draw out exactly the right adopter who was looking for this dog. So when you tell a story about a dog, it not only helps get attention, but it helps you draw out the adopters and the fosters who really would love to be living with a demonic Chihuahua. So it's really, there's no losing here. It's all winning. Next slide, please. So this is easy for me to say, I'm a writer, but how do you guys get these details? So I had, when I was working as an animal welfare journalist, I spent a lot of time talking to shelters and rescues and adopters about the pets who meant a lot to them and who I was going to be writing about. And I sort of developed a bunch of questions that I would ask them usually, in addition to sort of more specific questions depending on the story. But I had questions that I learned would sort of elicit the details that would help me give life to a pet and their story and all of that. So here are some of them. Does Fido have any funny little habits that make you laugh or smile? Now think about how you would answer that with your own pet, right? Like somebody asking you that question would help you draw out the details that would help them know who your pet is and help them write about your pet. Does Fido have a favorite toy? Does he have friends? What was Fido's life like before coming into the shelter or the rescue? Do we know anything about why Fido is in the shelter? What sort of shape was Fido in when she arrived to us? Does Fido have any personality quirks? What is Fido's personality like? What is a typical day like for Fido? What's her favorite and least favorite parts of the day? You probably think you already know what a typical day is like for her, but if you talk to the people who are working with her, they'll probably be able to give you some insights that you wouldn't already have. You know, a big part of this is not resting on your assumptions about what you think you know about what a pet is like or what a pet's story is, but actually trying to get to know them as an individual so that you can help share them as an individual and get people involved and engaged with them as an individual. So how did Fido get her name? What's the cutest thing about Fido? What have we done to help Fido at the shelter or the rescue? Can you share some pictures of Fido? This one is really important. You've got to get the pictures. I mean, whatever we write about animals, nothing grabs people with them more than a good picture or a good video. And there's nobody better to take pictures than a foster or the person who's working with the volunteers, the animal care staff, the people who really know Fido and, you know, can do more than just sort of snap what they think is sort of a generic nice picture of a pet, but who actually know the pet well enough to know, you know, oh, if I throw the ball like this, you know, she'll dilt her head in exactly the right way and we'll capture the perfect picture. And then a follow-up question that I ask whenever I do interviews is, what else would you like me to know? What didn't I ask you about? And this really gives people the opportunity to share the details, any details that you didn't come in thinking you needed to know, but that really do need to be shared because they give life to a pet story. They give life to a rescue story, an adoption story. Can I have the next slide, please? So turning these into a great narrative hook. Again, do not get overwhelmed. I know it sounds like it can be overwhelming, but you don't need to write a masterpiece. Again, just think about the adoption ads that we looked at. They were very simple. All they did was give a little bit of life to a pet who otherwise could just sort of get lost in the crowd. The goal is to share the information you have in a way that's going to resonate with the public. So for every piece of writing that you're doing, think, is this something that would grab my best friend? Would my cousin want to share this Facebook post and get it out to some new potential adopters? You know, if I start telling my mom about this cat, is she going to want to hear more? So just always try to think about your readers and the public whenever it is that you're putting out some public communication. An adoption ad is public communication. Adoption ad is a story. So always be thinking, how is the public going to receive this? And along those lines, remember that the public does not work in animal welfare. So often we're tempted to use acronyms and abbreviations in terms of art, But using those terms can be a barrier on their own. I mean, it can really make people feel like they are excluded from adopting, that they're not welcome at your shelter because they don't know what HW plus sign means. You know, they don't know what all of these acronyms mean. So always be thinking, how can I, again, I mean, unless your mom also works in sheltering, think, how would I talk to my mom about this? What questions would my mom have? If I sent this adoption ad to my mom, would she know what it means? And if the answer is no, then reword it. Just put it in simple English so that regular people can look at this and feel like you want them to participate in your organization. You want them to adopt, you want them to foster. You're not saying only people who already know what all of this means are welcome to come here.
Hey, Aaron, I'm going to echo exactly what Dr. Berliner is saying in the chat, that number one, this conversation is so important. And number two, you are so damn talented. I know that we do need to move on to Claire in just a second, but did you have closing thoughts for us on this?
I think, well, let me see. Can you just, yeah. So the last closing thought is just check out the other shelters that are doing it well. There's a whole bunch of them. And I would really invite you to share with me other shelters that you're seeing doing it very well, because I am always on the lookout for really great adoption ads and really great sort of social media and storytelling. I'll put my email address here. Please get in touch anytime. Oh, I just sent that to Bobby, not to everybody. Bobby already has my email address. Yeah, please get in touch anytime. And if you ever see anything that's really great or want to talk over how you can better tell a pet story, please reach out. I'm happy to sort of just brainstorm with you how to do it. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Aaron. And just another quick plug. I know this was really fast, but yes. Aaron is also going to be speaking at Best Friends, which is going to be a whole entire session. So if y'all haven't signed up or planning on going, highly recommend.
With a much more professional PowerPoint there that we will have figured out how to use in advance. That one's going to be a full session on storytelling to save lives. So we'll get beyond adoption ads and get into a lot more. But I hope that was helpful. And I really mean it. Please reach out anytime. I love talking about this stuff and would be thrilled to talk more about it with anyone who wants to.
Thanks, Aaron. All right, Claire, straight over to you.
Thanks, Bobby. Thanks, Aaron. That was really amazing. And I think a lot of great tips for everyone here. I know I need to go back and look into that. So I wanted to shift gears here a little bit and talk about transport programs, transfers. We saw a few weeks ago before the new year, we saw the data from Pet Health that transfers were alarmingly low or down. Behind the data, what we're hearing from, and this might sound familiar, destination partners feeling like they can't help the same number of animals that they could in the past, that there's not enough fosters, there's not enough adopters willing space. You know, they're constantly turning groups down from being able to transfer their animals in. On the flip side, I've heard, and I'm living here in Texas, so I can feel it, morale is low. It feels hopeless. Source shelters, I think, are feeling like they don't have a lot of outlets like they have in the past. And I wanted to bring on, even if you don't transfer out of state, I think some of what you're going to hear is just going to really resonate in terms of if you have any local partnerships. But I wanted to introduce or have them introduce themselves, four individuals that truly like have inspired me personally throughout the years in my career, have helped me literally through hurricanes and cold storms. And I am just so impressed with the work they do every day. And we've been through a lot together, all four of us. So I'll flip it over to Carrie, if you want to introduce yourself and say what organization you're from.
Hello, thank you for having me. It's nice to see you all. My name is Carrie Boynton, and I work at the Animal Adoption Center in Jackson, Wyoming. We are a small rescue organization in the northwest part of Wyoming. So we only have 7 dog kennels on site, and we usually have about 25 cats. But because of our foster network and the fact that all of our dogs go with fosters every night, we're usually able to have about 15 to 20 dogs in our program at any given time. And we primarily focus on helping overcrowded regional and national groups with at-risk animals.
Thanks, Carrie. Janine, over to you.
Hey, everybody. My name is Janine Fouché, and I'm the executive director at Acadiana Animal Aid in Lafayette, Louisiana. And we are a nonprofit animal shelter. We generally handle about 2,500 animals a year. And we are both a receiver because we're pulling animals from municipal shelters throughout the state. And we're also a sender because we have a national a monthly transport program generally to Colorado, but also some other areas in the US.
Perfect. And Heather?
Yep. My name is Heather Hall. I was a 10-year New Orleanian, so happy to be on a call with somebody from the Bayou. I now live in Far West Texas, a little town outside of Big Bend National Park called Terlingua. If you look it up on the Wikipedia, it'll tell you the population is 37. There's no shelter here. And so I formed my little organization to be a resource for the vast tracts of Far West Texas that have no access to animal control. And have had more capacity than what that has produced. So I support a number of shelters along the border from Presidio to the far end of Big Bend National Park, pretty much. Most of those shelters are small, 4 to 6 kennels, no bedding, no food, no transports, no adoptions, no promotion, no website, no nothing. So in my mind, they're pretty much underground dogs too.
Thanks, Heather. And Jess.
Hi, I am Jess Alton. I am from Gloucester Matthews Humane Society in Gloucester, Virginia. My shelter is primarily we send out dogs primarily and cats, but we also take in animals. Typically, actually, it's because a lot of our municipal shelters out here in the middle of nowhere don't have transport programs. So we've been able to filter our success with our transport program down by, you know, when we have open space, pulling from municipal shelters around us to help fill transport slots that we've got. We do mostly throughout the East Coast, pretty much anywhere on the East Coast we'll go, but we're hoping to, you know, expand a little further. So.
Perfect. Thank you all again for being here. And we don't have a PowerPoint or anything. I just am so eager to hear from you all and just have this conversation. I know I've talked to you all individually, but just to put it on a national scale, it's really exciting. But Carrie, I guess I wanted to start with you in terms of just, I know people are feeling frustrated and maybe overwhelmed, but your small rescue has done a lot in the last few years, but in terms of increasing your transport programs and how many, or your transport program, how many animals you're bringing in, what do you feel is the key to just increasing your program and increasing your bandwidth?
I think that ours has been sort of multi-tier. When we first started, we were really focused on groups that were close to us. And now that those programs have a lot more robust programming in place, they don't need our help like they used to. We do a spay neuter program across the state. So we're just seeing euthanasias go down statewide. But then we started looking further away and realizing just how big the problem was. And by collaborating with groups like Dogs My Co-Pilot, learning about ground transports so that we're able to do ground transports from Texas even in the winter, I think has been huge. We also were able to purchase a new vehicle. Our old vehicle only held like 6 or 8. And now we can transport. We did a 24 animal transport on Monday of last week. So I think the vehicle has helped. I also think engaging our community has really been a huge piece in terms of expanding our foster program. We used to be an open admission, people could come in all day. And so we were constantly doing daily fosters, and we shifted everybody to long-term. And now we do scheduled meet and greets, and we're not open to the public like we used to be. It's all by appointment, which has really freed up the staff to do a large intake. You know, we used to do 2 or 3, 5, maybe 10 on a big day. And now we'll do 24, 25 animals because we don't have the public in here all day. And through the community engagement, we've also been able to expand our foster pool. And we were talking about earlier in this meeting, those fosters really help promote the animals on their own social media. So we've been able to expand the animal types that we have in by working with broader groups and by expanding that community network. I feel like that's helped a ton, as it has developing a larger medical pool. A way that we've been able to help is to be able to have more funding for special medical cases so that when a group doesn't have any medical funding, they can reach out and say, hey, this dog came in with a broken leg, can you help them? Which at the end of the day really helps with some of the capacity. And finally, we built a puppy shelter offsite. It's called the Puppy Palace, where we can put a mom or a litter of puppies somewhere not on site, let them get a little bigger, get spayed neutered, and then get them adopted out once they've had their two-week quarantine. All of those things have really helped us increase capacity.
Awesome. And I think, you know, what the heart of this is just the partnership. And I know from a Southern perspective, and, you know, we're hearing a lot of, I used to be so desperate just for anyone to say yes, but now I think we're looking past that and how can receiving organizations give back more. You know, it's almost not acceptable anymore to just take animals in. So, you know, we're jumping into the partnerships. Like, I just want to hear what from you and Jess, we can start with you. Like, what do you think is the most important part of cultivating just really like more equitable partnerships for you all?
I think it's been a lot of a little bit of a culture shift on our end as well. You know, in the days of yore, a lot of things we were looking at, you know, give back fees. And those are awesome. No one ever says no to money. But one of the things we've tried to do here is to really expand beyond just give back fees. What other ways can someone bring something to the table? Just the same way that like, we can't always bring the same thing to the table every time. So partnering with groups that, you know, we have one group a couple hours away who loves orthopedic medical cases. They've taken every broken, you know, messed up joint, whatever in the last couple of years from us. They take them on call. We'll literally just make a call and they're like, here's the day to bring them up. That is so much more valuable than a give back fee. So things like that, you know, we have partners who will every now and then do a donation drive. And then when we do a transport with them, they'll give us this, you know, giant bag of donations or whatever they've collected from their supporters in our honor, which is really cool. And that's, again, always helps because there's a lot of animals to feed. I know you guys know that pain. So things like that, you know, or partners who can take animals who aren't spayed or neutered. I know here we have an offsite clinic. You know, it's a public low cost spay neuter clinic. So it's can be hard to get animals in and out of the clinic. For some of our partners who have in-house clinics where they can do surgery on site, they're like, yeah, send us all the unspayed and unneutered animals. We'll take care of it before they go up for adoption. So I think a big one is we had to stop looking for like, oh, well, give back fees are the way to, get kind of a partnership, you know, if they're giving you a give back fee, because some of these things are so much more valuable than just a give back fee for every time they pull an animal. So yeah. And then of course, you know, the more we started seeing that from our partners, the more our other partners kind of got on board, because if given the choice between sending an animal, you know, 12 hours north to a partner who needs fully vetted, fully everything, like, okay. Or if I have the choices in the same animals to a partner a couple hours away, who's going to meet us halfway and we can send them unspayed or unneutered animals, we're going to pick the second partner because it makes the most sense for us. So a lot of partners were like, oh, okay. And then they get on board because they also still want to receive those animals.
Absolutely. And Janine, you and I have talked at length about, you know, sort of the big picture with making more, you know, transports more equitable. I would love to hear what you have to say about it.
Yeah, so I think, you know, from my vantage point, I moved here from Seattle and it was, you know, it was very hard to adopt, you know, young animals, specifically puppies. And then I came to Louisiana and I was just completely blown away by the volume of puppies that are available to you every single solitary day. So it's kind of like I had to change my mindset. And for us, so much of the work is being done on the front end. You know, we're pulling animals from municipal shelters that are generally under-resourced. They may not have everything they need. We're providing veterinary care, taking them in, you know, and then sometimes, you know, paying to transport them out of state. So we were looking for other shelters that wanted to meet us, you know, in some way so that it felt more equitable in terms of the transfer partnerships. And we really have seen that starting to happen. I think as more and more people want to get on board with relocating and redistributing the overwhelming population in the South, you know, they want to help the sender who is often bearing the financial burden of moving those animals and making sure they're healthy for transport. There was one other thing I wanted to say about the big picture, and that is also about accuracy and honesty between these relationships. You know, for us, we're pulling from about 20 to 25 municipal shelters throughout Louisiana, and we really have to rely on them to provide us with very accurate information so that when we're taking it, whether it's behavioral or medical, and then by the same token, our receivers are expecting the same thing from us. So really being honest and accurate and transparent every step of the way has been extremely beneficial in cultivating very meaningful and deep partnerships.
Yeah, I think that's really important. I hear honesty is one of the biggest things when it comes to creating lasting partnerships. And Heather, I think everyone's intrigued with your intro in terms of I've been out there and you've showed me around in terms of your very rural location in Presidio and Terlingua. So do you want to give just a little bit of feedback about your partnerships and what you think has been most important?
Sure. I'm really new to this. I was a driver of dogs in a very limited role for several years before I decided to jump right in and try to do more. So I feel a little insecure about being on this call, actually. But I would echo, I think, what Jess said, and just to say that for me, because it's so rural and resources are so limited and there's no municipal money and there are very few fosters and the closest airport is 350 miles away, the closest ground transport pickup is 6 or 7 hour drive away. Information for us, the feedback loop is more important than any amount of give back fee, because we can use that information to raise our own money, to engage our fosters, to keep our vets. We don't have any shelter vets here. We just compete for limited space with paying private customers. And that feedback loop, if we didn't have that, I think we'd be pretty much dead in the water, to use a blunt term. We don't get to celebrate adoptions here. I mean, very, very infrequently. I wanted to tell you that the Presidio shelter had 125 intakes. It had 4 adoptions this year, all year, 100, you know, one of them was to the animal control officer. And so just on an emotional level, if the last time we see dogs that we have put in some pretty significant effort to get to the vet, to get into a foster, to raise money for, to get to an airport, if the last time we see them is when we push them into a kennel and we send them off, Nobody can do that for very long. But the fact is, we have some partners, and I think Jess's point also that, you know, we all boats rise together, you know? So like OTAT is our main receiver. They live stream their arrivals. I am usually about Abilene on my way home from the airport when I see the dogs coming off the plane. I literally watch OTAT cut their zip ties and the dogs come off the plane. And that kind of transparency is just like what keeps me going. I get that feedback to the fosters within a few hours. It makes them feel good, et cetera. So I guess that would be my kind of soapbox for the day, is just that, you know, sometimes we do hit a wall with money or fosters or veterinary issues, but medical mostly, that we can't really respond to. But having the information and being able to celebrate an adoption 1,800 miles away because we can't celebrate them locally has been super critical. And it's also, I think, helpful on the honesty piece and the information piece that Janine mentioned. We live in a really rural environment. I can't walk a dog down a city street and assess their reactivity because we don't even have sidewalks, you know? And so for me to try to develop strategies to anticipate which dogs will be successful in highly urban areas, usually Portland, Seattle, or Boise, it's really helpful to watch certain dogs and learn about their behavioral sort of journey when they're in Portland, and to be able to adapt and do a better job. I mean, I'm never going to be able to simulate Portland and Terlingua, but I'm able to do a better job because there are things that I'm able to screen based on their feedback. So that's my plug, is just for the feedback loop. I think that when you get into these huge, almost machinated transports that are 250 dogs at a time, it's really difficult. I'm shipping a cargo load, 21 kennel units, 6 dogs usually. It's easier, but to some degree, like, every dog matters, every dog's an individual, every dog has a story, and like being able to, as a receiver, ship that back to us is, I think, really critical, because we know we have a problem here in Texas and we've internalized that to some degree psychologically. But to hear it repeated over and over and over that like the dogs aren't rescued until they get to Oregon is not really true. You know, they're rescued when I pull them from the shelter, because I'm not gonna let them fail. But if the narrative is just that what I do doesn't matter, and they're only rescued once they get to a place where they can be adopted, I mean, that's, it's disrespectful, but it's also just really demoralizing. So I think that just being aware of that is really critical. And I would much rather have feedback than money.
Absolutely. I think that's so important in terms of, we rarely hear that, you know, what it feels like to hear those things on kind of the source shelter side. Absolutely. And Carrie, I want to turn it to you quickly. I mean, I think moving it to the sense of urgency, I know of organizations that have empty kennels and have even thought of maybe laying off staff because they just, you know, it's easier not to transport in. And Janine, later, I want to hear about your sort of perspective on this, but you know, Heather sees the urgency and Jess sees it and Janine, you know, seeing it in the shelters, but you might be a little bit more removed from it. But how do you instill that urgency with your team without getting eyes rolled when you say we're bringing in another group of dogs today or something?
I would say for us, I think to your point a minute ago, Heather, is having these relationships with the different organizations and knowing when they tell us something is going on, that it is. And we also try to send our team. We have a really small team, but you know, a few of us flew down to Laredo, Texas to visit with our partners there. We spend a lot of time on the Wind River Indian Reservation where we pull a lot of our dogs from. And I think just really connecting with those places, those people, hearing the stories, and then being able to share that need, you know, internally, and then through our social media outlets and with our donors. I think that's been nice for us in terms of keeping everybody feeling like we're all working on this together, like we're all on the same bigger team, has been really inspiring. Like we've had a few donors step forward who are helping us fund spay neuter initiatives in Laredo, Texas, in their shelter. When we talked to that group, that was a limiting factor for them, was how do we, you know, we can't get the animals out because they're not fixed, because partners can't take them before they're fixed. So we started helping with those pieces. So I think, again, on that communication loop, it makes our team feel like they're part of solving this bigger problem, even though it's maybe not in Teton County, Wyoming. But knowing those people and knowing that there's ways that we can help is also huge for us. You know, Claire and I will brainstorm like, oh, well, hey, if we just got vaccinations into this rural shelter, the animals can get into the pipeline. And we're like, okay, like I have a donor who's happy to fund that, which helps us because we're tiny. You know, we'll only adopt out 500, 400, 300 animals this year. But if we can help through spay neuter and through other give back programs that aren't like $25 a dog, they're more strategic, you know, like paying for spay neuter because that's the problem there, or working to develop a foster program in a city that's 1,800 miles away from us. I think those are ways that really capture the imagination of our staff, our community, our board, and get people fired up. You know, when we see that plane come in, like they've been following this dog since they were in Laredo or El Paso or wherever, and then they meet him and it's so exciting. So I think building that broader sense of community, you know, like we're all in this together across the country, has been super motivating for our team.
Absolutely. Yeah. And same question for you, Jess. How do you instill the urgency with your team and your colleagues?
So one of the things that I have really, really enjoyed is that, so my boss is the operations director, and she's the one who's in charge of going to the local municipal shelters and like physically grabbing dogs, bringing them back on our van for, you know, transports or just when we have extra space. And you know, she'll come back and she'll be like, I'm going to get four dogs. We've got space for four dogs. And then we leave a few open kennels, you know, and she comes back with like 10 dogs. And we're like, oh my God, she's done it again. But the reality is, and she's taken some of us with her, is she gets there and she physically sees how packed it is in this municipal shelter that has to euthanize for time and space. She's witnessing it firsthand every week at minimum. There's been a couple times where she's, you know, staff has been kind of like, we're a little bit run down or we're a little bit tired, and she'll be like, come with me. And we get there and we see, and we're like, what do you mean we're taking 10? We can fit 14, let's go. And it's contagious. I think a lot of times, even in animal rescue, we shy away from the uncomfortable and we shy away from these realities that we don't want to think about, like having to euthanize for time or space, especially if you're in a shelter where you don't have to do that. And so I think physically going and seeing it, it motivates me, especially like, I'm like, okay, I've got a transport coming up. Let's see if I can squeeze like one or two more dogs on that sucker. Like, let's see, because it's not only just, you know, I don't want to just help our shelter, and our shelter doesn't want to just help ourselves. We want to create a better community for animals and a better region and a better state. You know, it all trickles down. But yeah, I think being able to really see it firsthand is critical.
Absolutely. And 30 seconds, if we have it, Bobby, Janine, this has flown by, but I don't know if you could close us off with just this conversation with your thought about kind of responsibility. I know we've talked about that a lot for destination partners. Like, maybe this isn't my responsibility to solve that problem. Do you have, just sorry to put you on the spot with such little time, but do you have any closing thoughts on that?
You know, I think the thing for me is that, again, I was in Seattle where it was very hard to adopt animals. And it wasn't until I came to the South that I understood just how bad the overpopulation problem is. And so I feel like it's my job to really communicate that openly and honestly, and just let people know what we're up against. And my hope is if they have a need and they are interested in providing adoptable pets for their community, they'll know that there are a ton of states that have them. And we'd love to talk to you about, you know, healthy, equitable partnerships.
Perfect. Thank you so much, all four of you. You're amazing. And we didn't have enough time. We'll have to continue this conversation. So over to you, Bobby. Thanks.
Thanks so much, Claire. And I did want to just mention in the chat, Denise, we saw your message. One of the amazing things that the Supply and Demand Working Group is also doing is interviewing a lot of people from different shelters. So we would love an opportunity to interview you and learn more about what's going on in Florida. But Mary Smith, I'm going to toss it right over to you to close us out.
All right, you guys, here we are back in 2022. I want to thank Claire and all the speakers today. And one of the things I want to point out is that the speakers represent about four or five different states, and yet they're all coming together and working together. So I can't emphasize enough the value of mentorships and friendships and partnerships. So if you're interested, the Human Animal Support Services has put together a thing called Job Alikes. It is the craziest title I've ever heard, but it is literally that. People who have the same titles as you have are coming together to meet on a regular basis to talk and share about challenges and opportunities. And I think it is one of the best superpowers that we have that we can use, is when we can come together as a team, where it's not just on your shoulders, but it's actually a burden that you can share with others. And there are about a half a dozen job titles that have these job-alike groups that have formed, and more will be rolling out in 2022. So I would urge you to get a buddy. Nothing better than being able to go through this path that we're on together with other people. So enjoy the rest of your day. Thanks for being here. Thank you, Bobby. Thank you, Claire. Thank you, all of the speakers and assistants that we had today. It really does take a village. There's no question about it. Happy New Year.
Bye.